us, victory is our battle cry. We're on the battlefield for Jesus. Come and join our happy throng. We're blood-washed, born-again believers, and we sing a joyful song. King Jesus is our mighty captain, and it's him we shall obey. We're on the battlefield for Jesus, winning souls for Christ today. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. We're on the battlefield for Jesus. Come and join us in the fight. Though the enemy be all around us, we shall not be put to flight. By faith we know we have the victory, and no matter what the cost, we will fight to rescue hopeless sinners. Not a soul must e'er be lost. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Day number 3 of our Bible conference, session number 10. Glad to have each and every one of you in the house of the Lord as we continue these very important meetings. Let's go ahead and get them standing by standing and turning to 625. 625, let the lower lights be burning. Send a beat gleam across the wave. Some poor, fainting, struggling seaman. You may rescue, you may save. Let's sing it out this afternoon.
Good to have an old friend here today, Pastor James McDonald. He is the pastor of Bethel Baptist Church in London, Ontario. That is Brother Cloud's home church, his sending church. That's where all of his books are printed. And I'd like him to come and open us in prayer as we start this next session.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we come before you, we just pray that your spirit would be working in us, that we would be in tune to your spirit, that we would know that your presence is among us, that you would work powerfully through the message that has been prepared. Be with Brother Cloud, rest his mind, also give him power through the leading of the Spirit on what to say. And God, may we have listening ears so that we might be corrected, we might be encouraged, and we might be rebuked where the Holy Spirit leads. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Brother Cloud, you come and give us what the Lord's laid on your heart.
Over it. Good to see each of you in the house of God this afternoon as we continue this Bible conference, the theme being evangelism. And again, we're glad to have the preachers here this week and each one of you. Now, any of my books are in the bookstore, new bookstore, Chief Cornerstone Baptist bookstore, and I'm excited about that bookstore. I think every church should have a bookstore. We have a bookstore in Nepal, really nice bookstore, lots of good selections of Bibles, Bible cases, and everything, concordances, all kinds of Bible study tools, and because where are people going to get these things? And we need to help people understand what they need to be getting, what they need to be looking for. So it has multiple benefits, but it's a major teaching tool. A pastor can only teach so much. If he were to teach 24/7, he still wouldn't be able to teach enough. Because we're to teach him to observe all things whatsoever I have taught thee. Well, that's the whole Bible. How can a pastor teach everyone the whole Bible all the time? All ages, not possible. So we need these helps, sound helps. My commentaries are in the bookstore, at least some of them, and I think we have almost 42 now, getting ready to publish the Pentateuch, which is five more. And we've gotten a lot of encouraging feedback from those commentaries. They're available, of course, online in ebook format, all of my books. But the commentaries, one lawyer from Florida, he's a friend, but he said, I'm in one room reading Isaiah with your commentary while my wife is at her desk reading Ezekiel with your commentary. We could both say with zero doubt that there is no commentary on earth we trust more than yours. Now, that was a good testimony. I paid them a lot of money for that. Another said, there is not a single Christian author, commentator that I trust and respect more than you. I'm extremely excited about the new commentary series. Another said, I'm getting a lot out of your commentary on Revelation. I have about 10 commentaries or so, and yours stands out so far as the best. Another one said, everything you write seems to have the Spirit of God behind it, and nothing is as exceptional as your commentary on general epistles. I've only finished going through the first 13 verses of 1 Peter, and you've already handled depression, angels, heaven, election, holiness, and our glorified bodies in such a deeply profound manner that it's as if I had never studied those issues before as a 35-year-old Christian and zealous student of Scripture. And that's Bill Hardicker, and I did have to pay a lot of money to him for that one. And so we've been encouraged by the response. those commentaries and the other books, and they are in the bookstore. And the idea is the bookstore will grow and get full. It's a nice-sized bookstore, and we're excited about that. And all the things this church keeps adding and keeps adding to, strong things, good things, just something new all the time, something new every time I come back. I've been coming here every year. New things, new, and not just the program, but things that are actually affecting people's lives. And you can see it. And it's just very exciting. Now, the subject is the message of evangelism that we started yesterday in 1 Corinthians 15. I want to read that again. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 11. The message of evangelism, which is the gospel, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 11. And I want to continue with this for a while today. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 11. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also ye are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 with brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me also, who, as of one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. Wherefore, therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so ye believed. And we looked at the content of the gospel, each of those words, in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4. And what we must know, the content of the gospel, what we must know in order to be saved. We must know who is Christ. We must know what is sin. We must know what is the Scripture. We must know what it means that Christ died for our sins. We must know what it means that he died according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and we must know that he rose again the third day. To understand sin, just one of those things, it requires understanding God's law to some extent, and that every infraction of the law will be punished. Every single sin, not only in deed, not only every lie that comes out of the mouth, but every lie that's in the mind. So we stand totally guilty, totally undone, without any hope, any possibility of salvation apart from salvation in Jesus Christ. So that's the purpose of the law as a schoolmaster, to show us a holy God and his standards and my sin, and then point to Christ as salvation. And here we're not talking about sowing the seed, we're talking about watering the seed. One man asked me last night, he said, how can you do all that, you know, in a few minutes? Well, you can't, of course. We're not talking about that. Most of what we do is sowing the seed. We just have a few seconds or a few minutes. And a cashier, well, you can't stand there and talk to him for 2 hours. He's working. And a cashier, somebody you meet in the park, somebody you meet at the door. Well, you got a few seconds or whatever, you give them a tract, you quote a Bible verse, you sow a little seed, much as possible in that time frame and context, and try to leave something there that God can use. But unless someone is willing to listen, unless someone is willing to give the time to listen, they can't be saved.
Amen.
It's not possible. And we don't see anything like that in the Bible. No one in the Bible got saved unless they were willing to give attention to the gospel and listen to it.
Amen.
I talked to a man today, and he absolutely would not, he tried not to listen to one word I was saying. He tried his best. And I tried to get through it in the midst of what he, his nonsense. This was the guy that believes that Jesus is black and Jesus only died for black people. That's very interesting. I've had two conversations with that man. He said, no, I don't love the souls of white men. I love the souls of black men. Well, bless his heart. And he wasn't listening. Well, that, until he starts listening, he can't be saved.
Right.
True for everybody. The woman at the well stayed and listened. She could have run off and said, I don't have time for this Jew. I got a bunch of boyfriends over here. The Jews at Pentecost listened to Peter. They listened. And he didn't only preach what is in Acts 2, he preached with many other words. The Ethiopian eunuch, he was ready to listen big time. How long did Philip stay in that chariot with him? We don't know. Heading down back toward home in Africa. And at Athens on Mars Hill, the most magnificent day that Athens has ever had is the day that Paul came by. That place renowned for great thinking and philosophy. Here comes Paul, the greatest philosopher, of course, because he had the truth. And there he got to preach on Mars Hill. And that's an interesting place. It's just a barren rock now. Still an interesting place to think about what happened there. And they have a bronze sign there, nailed to the rock, fastened to the rock, with that whole sermon in Greek. So Paul's still preaching there. But what happened there? Most of them were only interested until he, you know, just to the end of the little sermon we have in Acts 17. And then that was it for them. But some of them, the Bible says in Acts 17, 34, clave unto him. Those are the ones that got saved. Only them. In 1973, I was ready because of a lot of prayer, and God had beat on me a lot and prepared me to be ready to listen. And I was willing to spend 4 days with the man that led me to the Lord. 4 day Bible study. Well, you've got to be. And if you're not, if no one is, you're not seeing anyone who's willing to have a Bible study with you, then you're not seeing anybody saved, of course. Because that's just the way it works. So what in that situation? Well, triple down on prayer. Triple down. I don't know if that's proper, but it's more than double down. Triple down on prayer. That will change things. Well, things are just like this. No, they don't have to be just like this. And so we've talked about the message of evangelism, and I want to spend a little time also with the faith of the gospel. The message of evangelism, we're talking about the gospel. We looked at the content of the gospel, but now the faith of the gospel. The faith of the gospel, as we read the last verse, therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preached, and so ye believed. That's how we're saved, we believe. And that's repeated and repeated and emphasized throughout the New Testament. Salvation's by faith. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Through faith, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, it's faith. And but it's a certain kind of faith, and people need to understand that. What kind of faith is this? It's a very certain kind of faith, very special kind of faith. It's not really a kind of faith that we deal with in the rest of our lives. It's not just believing some historical fact. It is like that George Washington was the first president of the United States. No. And so I want us to consider 4 ways that saving faith is described in Scripture. All of these things, all of these elements are described in multiple ways. And that is so we can understand it. It takes all of the teaching of the Bible to understand something properly. But there's great learning in each one of these aspects so that more and more we can understand these things. What is repentance? What is faith? Well, four ways saving faith is described in Scripture. And that is, number one, saving faith is an undivided faith. Undivided. We see that in John 14, 6. What do we mean? We mean that Jesus is my only Lord and Savior. Undivided. Jesus alone. John 14, 6, Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Very exclusive. Acts 4, 12, neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Exclusive. Hinduism. Thousands of gods. They say millions of gods. Who knows? But there's only one thing you're forbidden. And that is to say Jesus is the only God and the only Lord and the only Savior. That's not allowed. Undivided. I've got to narrow down and put my faith exclusively in Jesus Christ. You can't be saved in any other way. People try to add Jesus to their other gods. They certainly do as Hindus. Add him. Can't add him to anything. He's it. He must be it. Saving faith number two is a trusting faith. It is a trusting faith. And that word in John 3:16, the common word for believe is Greek pistuo, and it means to place confidence in, to rely on, to trust, according to Vine. But it's translated commit 8 times. Commit yourself to. It's translated trust. It's a trusting faith. To be saved, a person has to fully trust his soul and eternal destiny to Jesus Christ. He must rely upon Jesus and Jesus alone to forgive his sin and make him right with God and carry him to heaven. It's a trust. It's like coming up to a lake and there's a boat and you want to go to the other side of the lake. And if you were to stand there and say, I believe that boat will carry me across the lake, well, that's just a middle thing. But if you get in the boat, then that is trust. And you're trusting yourself to that boat. There was this very famous tightrope walker, and he went across Niagara Falls some decades ago, and he would carry somebody. Well, that's trust, to be that somebody. Yeah, I'm going to get on your back, and you're going to carry me across that canyon there, across Niagara Falls. That's what we have to do with Jesus. It's trust. I trust everything to him. He's my 100% Savior. He was my 100% Savior 51 years ago. He's my 100% Savior today. Amen. And 100% trusting. People say they believe in Jesus, but they continue to go through their old religious rituals. That's not trusting. Saving faith is a whole heart, convinced faith, number three. Salvation requires the individual believe with all thine heart. Acts 8:37. The Ethiopian eunuch, here's water, what doth hinder me to be baptized? Philip, there was no pressure there, by the way. Philip didn't instigate that. Ethiopian eunuch instigated that. And Philip answered, if thou believest with all thine heart, well, your heart is your whole person. And that means with everything you are believing in Christ. No little side thing, simple thing. That's the kind of faith that Jesus' early disciples had. Peter, he was a character. He is a character. I don't know what he is now, but he was a character. And he was always saying things, but he said some magnificent things, such as in John chapter 6, verses 66 through 69, where the crowd left Jesus. They were disciples. They were believers and followers. Not really, because that day they left him. And so Jesus said to Peter, will you go away also? And Peter said, we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. We believe and are sure. That's the kind of believing it is. Good. Sure, huh? Sure, confident. I met a Nepali one time, and I asked him if he believed in Jesus. He said 99%. I said, that's not enough. If thou believest with all thine heart. Saving faith, number four, is a receiving faith. Saving faith receives Jesus as Lord and Savior. Jesus said, come to me, and saving faith comes. It doesn't stand off and look, it comes, receives. And so those are some of the major aspects of saving faith. We have to understand this. When we're dealing with people, we need to learn more and more about these things. And then we need to be able to tell sinners about these things and explain these things. And yes, they've got to be willing to listen. But if they're willing to listen, then these are the kind of things we need to deal with them about. And then watch for the work of the Spirit of God. That's all there is to it. It's God who saves sinners. We are laborers together with God. And in this section, we also deal with the security of the gospel. The security. If we look at verse 2 in 1 Corinthians 15, so the content of the gospel and the faith of the gospel and the security of the gospel in this section. And the security is seen in verse 2. 1 Corinthians 15, 2. By which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. Every one of those words is very important. The order of the words is important. And we have a magnificent Bible here, a magnificent translation. But there's two things here I want to point out, and that Paul definitely stated the doctrine of security. He said, by which ye are saved. Not will be saved, not might be saved. Saved, I'm saved. You are saved. Paul said that to the Corinthians who had believed. You are saved. That's eternal security. It's a gift. Salvation's totally 100%. A gift that Christ purchased, 100%. Of course there's security. I don't do anything for it. It is a gift that was purchased by Christ. Definitely, all through the Bible, there is security there. But we see also, number two, that Paul also stated the doctrine of perseverance here. And that's a very important doctrine. The doctrine of security is a biblical doctrine, but it is not for anyone, just anyone who professes Christ or prays a sinner's prayer. Eternal security is for saved people. That's not complicated. It's only for saved people. And we see that here. If we notice the verbs and the order of this thing, by which also ye are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you. Oh, well, that means I've got to hold out faithful. No, it doesn't say that at all. It says you are saved right now. It's not a future thing that if I do this, I will be saved. It doesn't say that at all. It contradicts that. I am saved. If I am saved, I am saved. If I'm born again, if I've come to Christ in repentance, saving faith, I am saved. What is the continuing then? It's evidence. And there will be evidence. Amen. And that's very important. The whole quick prayerism thing, they have people pray a prayer even if they have to manipulate them and trick them. And then they immediately, part of that program is to give them assurance. Now, what did you do? Well, I prayed, you know, asked Jesus to save me. Well, then what are you now? Well, I guess I'm saved now. And not if you're not saved. You're not saved if you're not saved. But if you are saved, you will continue with Christ. And that's clearly and exactly what it does say. We've got to read the Bible very carefully. And we've got to test preachers very carefully. Amen. And that's why you need to look at your Bible. Right. How can you test anybody if you just sit there? You don't have a perfect memory. Don't tell me you have a perfect memory. So we need to learn these things and test everything. There's the doctrine of eternal security. Two major aspects of it. Now I want to, what is the end of my time? I forgot to look. Huh? Right. Now I want to, the rest of the time, the session, to deal with evangelism and quick prayerism. I wanted to get this in somewhere. Us here, those of us here, we understand this, but this is being video recorded. This is going to be part of a new course that I'm publishing. And I want to inform people about this and continue to deal with this because it continues to be a massive problem among fundamental Baptists. A pastor in Chattanooga on this trip told me that he thinks the house influence is largely gone or very much going away, and I strongly disagree with that from my perspective. The sword of the Lord has taught quick prayerism since the 1960s. Let's see here. Let's go soul winning, Jack Howes. Sword of the Lord Foundation, 1962. Now that concept has spread everywhere. The vast majority of the soul winning programs teach this methodology. And vast majority. In fact, I don't really know of any ones that don't except my evangelism course, Sowing and Reaping. But I hear from people constantly that they're in churches that practice this, and they're very disturbed. And so we need to understand this and be on guard against it. What is quick prayerism? Well, it's an evangelistic methodology that is quick to get people to pray a sinner's prayer after a shallow gospel presentation, and usually without any hint of repentance. It is quick to pronounce those people saved and give them assurance and try to baptize them, even if they barely show any interest in the presentation and even if they give no biblical evidence of having been born again. Frequently, quick prayerism incorporates psychological salesmanship manipulation. In quick prayerism, an empty sinner's prayer has too often replaced Holy Spirit conviction and miraculous regeneration. Quick prayerism is characterized by soul-winning reports that are grossly exaggerated, since the number of real conversions are minute compared to the overall statistics. That's what I have named. That was the name I gave to it. Quick prayerism. It is quick. What is it? It's quick. An example of this was given by a pastor friend not that long ago, some years ago, and he went out to California to a big conference and went out on a Saturday visitation, and they partnered him with some veterans, and they came to a door. He said, we were immediately partnered, and we came to a door. The first door we went to, a friendly Catholic guy, and to my surprise, the guy got saved before my very eyes. He said he didn't even know it was happening. And as the soul winner took him from a few scripture passages to the sinner's prayers so smoothly that it caught me off guard. A lady, just a few minutes. A lady answered the bell at another house and stood impatiently behind the screen door while the soul winner went quickly through the plan of salvation. She wanted to attend to her child. She's her attention's on her child, not what that guy's saying. She didn't let them in the house. They're outside the house. But he gives her the Romans Road thing. She's severely distracted. At the end of his presentation, he boldly demanded that she open the door partially and take his hand. And she seemed shocked by this request, but she cautiously did as he said. He then asked her if she wanted to go to heaven when she died. When he answered in the affirmative, he asked her to pray after him the sinner's prayer, which she did. He announced her gloriously saved, and she immediately closed the door and went back to her business. That's quick prayerism. What is it? It's a set plan. It's a set plan that you use with every single individual. If they ask you a question, you'll say that you say, well, that's a good question, we'll deal with that later. Let's stay on this plan. No matter who they are, what their background is, no matter if they can even speak English. That doesn't matter. Or if they're deaf, dumb, and can't read. In this book, deaf, dumb, and can't read. And a man led that deaf, dumb person that can't read to Christ by pointing to his heart, to his Bible, and to heaven. Doesn't matter. Quick prayerism. It's a set plan. It focuses on a ticket to heaven. Are you 100% sure that you will go to heaven when you die? If I could tell you how to be 100% sure that you will go to heaven when you die, you would be interested in it, in that, right? You've got to keep it positive. You would be interested in that. Salesmanship. And so, the saved person does go to heaven when he dies. If you're saved, that's never the way the Bible comes at this. Never, ever, not one example. Jesus didn't use that approach with the Samaritan woman. Woman, do you want to go to heaven when you die? Peter did not use that on Pentecost. Jews, do you want to go to heaven when you die? Paul did not use that in Athens. Ye men of Athens, do you want to go to heaven when you die? It's used nowhere. You say, well, what's the problem? We go to heaven when we die. Yes, but the emphasis in Scripture is on a new relationship with God now, starting now. Amen. It's very different. Jesus said in John 17:3, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. That's it. That's God's goal, that I might have a brand new relationship, be reconciled with him now, be a child of God, called out Abba by the direction of the Holy Spirit, Romans chapter 8, a brand new relationship with God. That's the main thing about salvation.
Amen.
Not heaven, God. God's amazing. God made me. And God's amazing. Everything about God is amazing. There's nothing I don't like about God. There's parts of God that scare me, but there's nothing I don't agree with and don't like and don't thrill me.
Amen.
His holiness thrills me. I'm glad God is holy.
Amen.
I'm glad he's just. Glad he's righteous. I'm glad he's almighty. Nobody can ever throw God off his throne.
Right.
He's a good God, but imagine if he wasn't almighty. Then the devil would have thrown him off the throne and we're a mess we'd be in, but can't happen. God's almighty,
amen.
And everything he is going to be and going to continue. Yeah, I love God, but I didn't love God before I was saved. But the best part of salvation is to know God personally forever, but beginning now. Quick prayerism, what is it? It uses a salesmanship program. Again, I've forgotten. Is it three what?
350.
50?
50.
Not 15, right? It uses, what is quick prayerism? It uses a salesmanship program. Now, Jack Howes taught this. Many others have taught this. Psychological tricks, but I'll read from him right here, from Let's Go Soul Winning. There are several ways to do this, he said, several ways to get people to pray the sinner's prayer. The goal is to get them to pray the sinner's prayer. He said, there's several ways to do this, but you must try to get them to pray. If he's really ready, say, could I pray with you? And while I pray, would you pray and ask God to save you today? Maybe he's not quite that ready. Maybe you don't know. So you could say, could I pray with you? Could I pray that you will get saved? Maybe you don't think he will let you pray to get saved. Then you say, could I have a word of prayer with you before I go? Now here he's going into a complete lie. Because he's telling someone he just wants to pray with them before I go. He's telling them he's going to go. And most of them are saying, that's good. That's what I want you to do. Go. Because they're not interested. But he says, I'll just pray with you. And who's going to say no to that? Hardly anybody. And he knows that. It's all psychological manipulation. But that's not what he's going to do. He's not going to pray with them before he goes. He's going to get them to pray a sinner's prayer through the mechanism of supposedly praying for them. It's all a trick. It's all a lie. You don't see a thing like this in the Bible. It's damnable. It is damnable. Men that say they're against this, but they're not really, 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 really against it, they don't hate it. They don't hate it like I do. This stuff is damnable. It's not a some little thing. And by the way, your preacher's friends will affect you. You better hang with the right preachers or no preachers. It won't hurt you to hang with no preachers if necessary. And if you're not willing to stand alone today, you won't stand. Not today, not among independent Baptists you won't, because the big crowd is going the wrong way, a whole bunch of wrong ways. Now, this is a lie. I'm not even going to go with the rest of it, but it's just psychological manipulation and lying to people. It's damnable. Cheap psychological manipulation. It's tricky. It's dishonest. What is quick prayerism? Well, it also focuses on the sinner's prayer, as we've seen. That's the focus. Here's an example of a sinner's prayer from the tract, God's Simple Plan of Salvation. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I deserve hell for my sins. I believe you died for me. I'm trusting you to save me from hell and give me the gift of eternal life. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Amen. Now, the sinner's prayer is not in the Bible. It can be traced, as best I've been able to find out, to about the middle of the 20th century. It's not very old. The American Tract Society was founded in 1825 during the Second Great Awakening. But it was not until 1955 that the American Tract Society published its first tract containing a sinner's prayer. It's a very new thing. It wasn't invented by Jack Hiles, but he's been was the biggest promoter of it. And he just focuses on the sinner's prayer. What's wrong with the sinner's prayer? Nothing necessarily. If the person's ready to be saved, he understands and the Spirit of God is working and he's ready to go with it. My wife said it helped her a lot, sinner's prayer. She didn't know anything, no church background at all. Started attending the Southern Baptist Church with my mother-in-law, and just as Bible ignorant as you could be. And in Alaska. And she said it helped her a lot. She just didn't know what to say, what to do. But it's not in the Bible, therefore it can't be a big thing. If it's not in the Bible, it can't be a big thing. Take it or leave it. Use it or not use it, depending on the situation. Some people might need a sinner's prayer. I didn't pray a sinner's prayer. I simply believed and repented in my heart. That's what I'm supposed to do. And that was salvation. In fact, I think the man that led me to Christ eventually, when I first met him, if he had tried to come with this 1-2-3 Romans Road, pray the sinner's prayer, I wouldn't have listened to him anymore. Because I knew that. I knew that. Problem line is, it's not in the Bible, so I can take it or leave it, use it sometimes, not use it. It's not the goal. Salvation's the goal. Jesus didn't say to the Samaritan woman, I've got a prayer for you to pray. Paul didn't say to those Athenians, I've got a prayer for you to pray. Never, nothing. There's just nothing like that. Well, what about Romans 10? Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Right, but there's no specific sinner's prayer, there's what I'm saying, but that's what quick prayerism emphasizes. And then, what is quick prayerism? It ignores repentance. Oh, yes. And we're going to deal with that, the Lord willing, later. And then, what is quick prayerism? It promises eternal security to those who pray a sinner's prayer. Right there, that is considered the salvation. That prayer. If I could just get somebody to pray that prayer, then they're saved. It's all nonsense, really. But they're saved, and so I can give them assurance right now. And it does. The Quick Prayerism program gives security to those who pray the sinner's prayer. Some churches even give them a spiritual birth certificate. And after Hiles would lead somebody in a sinner's prayer, he would say, let me ask you this question now. According to this book, where would you go if you died right now? The person says, to heaven. This means you're God's child, Hiles would say. Now suppose somebody asks you tomorrow, Mr. Doe, are you a Christian? When you become a Christian, what are you going to tell them? Yes, yesterday I became a Christian. So you're giving eternal security to these people just because they prayed a sinner's prayer. What about security? Well, I believe in it. But it comes from two directions. It cannot come from me. I can't know the mysteries of that man's heart. It can't come from me, but I can show them where it comes from. It comes from, number one, the promises of the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life, if you believe savingly. But it also comes by the Spirit of God. Look at Romans 8, 15 and 16. Who gives eternal security? Who gives the confidence that you're saved? The Spirit of God, using the Word of God. Not me, the soul winner, me, the preacher. Romans chapter 8, verses 15 and 16. Here is the author of security. For ye have received the, no, not. Ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. There's security. Comes the Spirit of God using the Word of God, confirming that you have done this. I have received you. God is saying, I've received you. You cry, Abba, Father. What is quick prayerism? Well, it produces large numbers of empty professions. That's characteristic. And you can always tell it by this. Jack Hiles claimed that 750,000 people were saved at Hammond under his ministry, Hammond, Indiana being nearby. In 1969, Jack's son Dave Hiles, 16-year-old high school sophomore at the time, organized the teenage soul winning program at First Baptist. Dave's sister, Cindy, who later married Jack Scoff and is now divorced from that wicked man. Dave's sister, though, when she was a teenager, Cindy, who participated under the direction of her brother, said, I won thousands of souls before I finished my teen years. That's a lot. I don't know if you started figuring that up, how many, you know, it'd be every day, just about. Thousands. The one girl. In 1972, at age 19, Dave Hiles became the youth pastor there. And in 6 years, the teens reported 100,000 salvation decisions. Now, in 1974, Elmer Towns, who wrote books on church growth, he described an experience. This is in the world's largest Sunday school that he wrote. He described an experience at Hammond on a Saturday with First Baptist Youth and Soul Winning, led by Dave Hiles. He said more than 200 teens showed up, and Dave told them, last week we won over 1,000 souls to Jesus Christ. 200 teens showed up, but that's not very many when you think that 750,000 people had gotten saved, you know, in those years. But 200, that's a lot in a way. So there they are. And Dave said to them, last week we won over 1,000 souls to Jesus Christ. Last week we did that, those 200 teens. Let's do it again tonight. So Towns accompanied one of the buses, 31 young men on a bus to an inner city area in Chicago. The young men told him that they had 21 out the week before, that one little group, and had won over 200 to the Lord. And that week they aimed for 300, more than 300. And so Elmer Towns is doing research. He said, Joe stopped at the first home, 9 played on the porch. Hey, would you like to ride a bus to church tomorrow morning? He began talking about God. The kids didn't know much about him. Within minutes, the group swelled to 15 curious Spanish kids. He talked about creation, the message of Calvary, If you were to die tonight, would you go to heaven? Joe asked, pointed his finger at each of the kids. All shook their heads negatively. I want you to bow your heads right now and pray to receive Jesus Christ. He did not ask if they wanted to be saved or if they're ready. He just told them to pray, and they go to heaven. Most of them repeated the simple prayer after him. As each boy jumps on the bus, they're going back now, he reports how many had been won to the Lord. 26 is the highest number. One is the smallest. Total of 261, they almost hit 300. For the evening, all the guys cheered. Well, that's it. In grossly inflated numbers. Grossly inflated. To all kinds of various degrees. And that spread all over the world. All over the world. For several weeks in 1977, my wife and I followed up on a foster club soul winning program in a Fundamental Baptist Church in Florida. Foster Club was a ladies soul winning. And they had been going out every week. No follow-up at all, but they'd been going out every week, coming back with all these statistics of people that won to Christ every week. And so the pastor said, well, I'll tell you what you can do. You and your wife can go follow up these foster club. Well, we did. We went up to house after house after house there in Central Florida, and not even one person would let us in the door. Now, that's some kind of strange salvation. In the late 1990s, we were given the decision cards to follow up a county fair ministry in Oklahoma. Of the hundreds of professions that were recorded, we could not find even one person who was even interested in attending church. They all profess Christ at that. By the way, county fair ministry would be good if it were done right. Not if you're just trying to push people to pray a prayer right there. If it were done right, anything to get out the gospel is good. Pastor Friend followed up on the more than 100 salvation decisions that were made at a county fair ministry in Kentucky in 2011. Pastor Friend. He did not find one soul who was even interested enough to attend church. Those people aren't saved. That's nonsense. In 2024, a pastor friend in Florida had exactly the same experience with Amazing Grace Ministries. They're the ones that do the county fair things and other things. And he had been given the decision cards. They don't follow up. And so he got the decision cards and he went through and trying to find people that might be interested to attend church that he could help and teach the Bible to, but they weren't interested at all. They had prayed a sinner's prayer and they weren't saved. And that is a major characteristic of quick prayerism. What's the problem? It's not scriptural. Number two, the vast majority of people who've been dealt with haven't gotten saved. Number three, it gives people false security. Number four, it inoculates people to true biblical salvation. Oh, I've done that. Number five, it is sown confusion about true salvation. Everywhere it is practiced. Quick prayerism.